Welcome again to Third Company Gaming, back to our Dungeon of Graves, whereupon our heroes have surveyed the carnage. After fighting a pretty good-sized horde of goblins with a especially vicious goblin leader, but they've all fallen and are littering the ground, and Vaughn and Saris will be taking a back seat today. Over here they are discussing things. So it is on you guys, you three. How are you doing health-wise?
Very poorly. You know, me or Barnaby?
Looking at that 6 out of 24, I think both of you.
Yeah, Barnaby is not doing well.
All right.
And I need to double check, I'm pretty sure we don't have very much healing going left.
Ooh, nope.
It was a rough fight. Well, what I'll do with NPCs, let me look at Cerus. NPCs were out. I will sometimes use them for healing. I show one slot available.
No, she used them all up. She must have just not thrown them in there because we've been talking back and forth. We were both absolutely dry.
Okay, it was a tough fight. That was a really good sort of boss battle kind of situation. Well, you can take a short rest here. Things seem to be relatively calm. You don't really hear anything. I don't know. Make a perception check.
Perception, my greatest weakness. Actually, it's not. But it's
nah, you guys
not good.
You guys will hear a thing.
That's fine. We're all fine here.
We're talking.
If you wish to take a short rest, you can. You could take a hit die.
If I had a hit die. Oh wait, I do.
You guys
yeah, we didn't use those. We,
you do.
We
haven't used a hit.
That's right.
Yeah, you guys haven't used a hit die yet.
Is that what you want to do?
I think it's a good idea.
All right, I suggest we take the tables and the chairs and we block off the doorways just to be sure.
Didn't work well for the goblins.
No, but at this point in time...
Although doors are our worst enemy.
Right.
Well, you believe that you caught the goblins kind of halfway through the job.
Sure.
They were still, you still heard some dragging noises. So if you want to shut that door and put the table across there, you could do that.
That's what we'll do then.
Well, I will second wind before resting.
Okay.
That's how you do it.
That's exactly how much I need.
All right, you drag a couple of those tables over there and put them in front of the door.
I don't know that I looked in here. Was there anything of note in there?
You take a look, and if you recall, one of the goblins that came out was armed with an apron on and a cleaver, and as it kind of suspected, or that would suggest, there is sort of a kitchen and pantry area in there.
Okay.
All right, well, you take that short rest. What do you wish to do right now?
I think we wanted to continue to clear the building.
We did.
So
we gotta do something with the blacksmith.
We don't have to touch the polymorph dragon. He can do his own thing.
Sure, the druid wants to go commune with the big old bird, let it know that the vermin have been driven off.
I do. But I know you want to speak to the smith who is still making a racket over there as well.
Yeah, you can hear from here.
He just does not care.
Does not at all.
Big pantry.
If there's nothing else in here, let's creep around and see what we can find.
Yeah, we got the dagger and the necklace that was on the goblin. Was anything else of note around on the bodies? Any there sigils from where they may have been from?
Nothing. Well, on the priestess goblin, you'd found a kind of a crude holy symbol of Orcus.
Right.
But on, no, there's no real clan insignia or that you, at least that you recognize on the goblins here.
Since the goblin boss kept talking about the
he did, he was talking about, yeah, he had mentioned that he was, that he was trying to separate himself from these surface goblins that he mentioned somewhat derisively, as if his kind were a bit more advanced or stronger in some fashion. And he was pretty tough. He was certainly referencing a different variety of goblin than the kind of skinny little scrawny ones that go down with one shot.
All right, so where do we want to investigate next?
Yep,
do we want to run off to the smith, or we want to keep checking around for other doors? What are we doing?
Blood Moon looks over and says, we should make sure the rest of this place is lacking goblins.
Yes, that's
before we head into the courtyard.
Okay. Well, there are doors you've not gone through, so you can check it out.
Yeah, and there's no other exits in here, right? Just the two that we know of?
Correct.
Alright. So I'll go out this way.
Alright, one corner.
Blood Moon's gonna look through here. See what he can see.
It's a pantry and kitchen.
Anything worthwhile to eat?
The food doesn't look terribly appetizing. Make an investigate roll to kind of poke around if you want to.
14.
Okay. Hey, in the pantry area, you find there's still an intact shelf, and you're not sure where the goblins got it from, but there's a decent selection of cooking spices, and that some of them are somewhat rare and probably have some value.
I'll take them.
The food doesn't seem terribly appetizing, but the spices looted from somewhere, you're certain, are probably somewhat valuable. I mean, how spices were in the Middle Ages, they can be very valuable.
Yeah, like saffron.
I will grab them and take them.
Even pepper.
I say, Middle Ages, we're talking anything.
Right.
That's why onions and garlic. Well, that's all we got, so let's use lots of it.
And it looks like this is just an empty room attached to the pantry.
That is the pantry. So this is the kitchen right here, and that's the pantry there.
Okay. I will catch back up with Barnaby.
Only because I don't remember. Did we check what's in this room?
We
usually did.
I don't remember. Try the door. Is it locked?
It is not locked.
Okay, I'll open the door.
Roll me a d20. Strength check. I'll assume you got it. You muscle the door open, and I don't recall if you guys surveyed this room or not. It looks somewhat ransacked. There's some weapon racks. A fair amount of weaponry. Some of it in decent repair. A bunch of arrows, some spears, a couple shields. There are 4 spears, 4 short swords, 4 shields, and 100, well, if you spent the time to count them, 100 arrows. There's quite a few arrows, let's put it that way. You guys already went in this room. It was a way to get to the second floor, but it has collapsed. Correct.
Okay. Blood Moon will head to this door, because I know we didn't go down here.
These doors are open. They look into maybe small bed chambers, but they're other than a little bit of refuse in the corner, some dust and some stucco from the ceiling, they're just empty.
Okay.
And this one in the back, continue down. Same thing?
Same thing.
And these are the stairs that are caved in, that were caved in above.
No. Those stairs are going down. They're not caved in.
Ooh. Then Blood Moon looks over to Barnaby and says, I'll go first.
No. He's gonna sneak I'll go down, down first.
See how that works out. Yes, sir. And I apparently am suffering because Barnaby is coming down with me.
Yes.
So no chance of being stealthy here.
Never is. Not with you guys. Not with Barnaby right here.
What do you mean? I'm silent.
Worried about it.
Wow. Actually, you are.
Even with this advantage? Oh, yeah. Nice.
Mm-hmm.
You go down an increasingly dark staircase and arrive where there is a... Do you guys have a light on?
I think Alara has a torch.
Yeah, I have one.
Okay. So that means if you're holding the torch, you don't have a shield up.
Yes, I know.
Okay.
I'll check the door.
When you say check, what do you mean by that?
Does it look like it's locked? Does it have a lock or is it just a pull handle?
It is not... make a check. You're not really super used to doors. I mean, you are used to doors, but it does not... It appears to have a locking mechanism, but...
I'll try pushing it lightly.
It does not appear to be locked. You kind of look at where the bolt would throw, and the bolt is withdrawn. It is not thrown across.
Is it open in or out?
It opens in to that room.
I'm going to quietly push it slightly to look inside.
Okay, you lift the latch. If you want to make... All right, make a stealth roll as you do that, please.
Nope. I asked that really good.
You did, and you hear a guttural voice going, who's out there?
Did the hammering stop like it did in the audio?
It stopped. It stopped because you guys went downstairs.
Okay. I just noticed it wasn't there.
As you went downstairs, the sound of the hammering went away. There's a room with a lit torch in there.
Oh, good.
And you see moving into view an enormous looking gnoll. He's carrying a great axe. He's dressed in scale armor. He's just looks a little meaner and bigger and tougher than the ones that you've dealt with so far.
Well, I throw a javelin at him.
All right, well, we're going to roll initiative first, because that's how the game works.
Boo. Like, boo!
Is that another one?
That is another one. It's going to be one of those nights, my friends.
Wow.
I'll join you with that one.
You guys are phenomenally bad. What's your dexterity, Alara?
12.
Well, okay. The answer is yes, Marcus. Well, you guys are in a bad way. So
we're in a good way. It's three on one.
It's 3-on-1, but he's going to hold this little corridor, so it's hard for you guys to all get there. And, Blood Moon, you are front and center, and,
Unfortunately.
Unfortunately, you are.
So we're gonna see how bad of a thing this is. That is a hit.
That is gonna be a hit, and it's a great axe.
Oh, yeah.
Great.
And you
how
are
did
not...
it pierce?
I should have redone the thing. It's okay. It's not piercing. It's slashing. Yes.
Pierce you with that thing. You're dead.
A resounding hit.
Yes, he does.
He does. All right. What are you guys going to do? He is just chopping away with this great axe. He hits you for 11 points, leaving you just 2 points away from going down.
Mm-hmm.
I would have said parlay, but we're beyond that.
He didn't seem like the parlaying type.
I guess it's Alara.
Yeah, since he already went. Well, I doubt he's going to just forget that we walked down here. So I'm going to bravely plant myself. I'm going to push Blood Moon out of the way and plant myself right in front of him and stick him with my sword. Actually, I'll stick him with the sword. And then I'll probably throw the torch at him with my other hand. Because, well, looks like there's a torch blowing, burning behind him, and I'd much rather have a shield. Oh, suck.
And this is where you die.
Yeah, probably. That's
Blood
okay.
Moons? What do you have in mind?
Valiant.
Well, I'll tell you exactly what I have in mind.
Retreat.
I'm going to take wolf shape.
All right.
I recharge those on a short rest.
Oh,
which
nice.
Which we just did. So.
Okay, you are a wolf. That is an action, though, without being a
circle. That is correct. Without being a moon druid, it's an action. So.
Okay, that is your action. Got it. Barnaby, you can get a swing at him. He's sort of there in the doorway. I'm going to say that you have a minus. He has some cover. He has minus two to hit. I mean, you could try to push him back. That would be an action to kind of get more space so you could surround him. He is in an advantageous position right now.
Nah, I'm not gonna shove him. Not much. I don't think that'll work out for us.
Okay. Alara, what is your armor class right now?
17.
17. All right. Fortunately, he misses. Rolling an 8. You are up again. He is just trying to smash through this doorway. He's in a good position, but it's pretty tight confines for an axe of that size.
Yeah, and now that I have thrown my torch over his head, I'm going to pull out my shield and try to stick him around it and not roll a 1. Though I'm just like Barnaby.
Just like Barnaby. Blood Moon, you are a wolf. Do wolfy things.
I'm going to do wolfy things with pack tactics.
18 does hit. Rawr, 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 rawr.
Eight piercing.
That's a good move for a wolf. That's yes, pretty impressive. That's a lot of damage. Noel looks very surprised that, number one, that you're a wolf, and number two, that it hurt that badly.
Surprise, druid.
Barnaby, you're up.
No, the target is a creature. It must succeed a DC 11 strength saving throw or be knocked prone.
Oh, you are correct.
Oh,
thank
yes,
you
it
for
does.
Pointing that
yeah,
out.
It is.
Oh, you get advantage attack as the wolf brings him to the ground.
In true honorable paladin form.
You will let him stand up at first.
Well, let's see. He's prone. Can I move through his square now a little easier? Or is that not a thing? I don't know.
Not necessarily, no. Your best move. I mean, you have an advantage of the attack right now.
I know. So. I got to stab him on the ground like an honorable paladin. I know. You see, that's next level. Right now, I'm still just a regular guy.
Okay. 21 will hit.
8 points.
8 more points on ye old jailer. He's a tough one, though. He will climb to his feet and hack at Alara again. What, Tracy?
It went 19 now.
That's a good thing, because that thing is going to hurt.
It hurts a lot, trust me.
It does. Alara, that was not... that was sort of minimal damage from it. Alara, you are back up. He rolled a 17 and barely missed.
It would be nice if I actually could hit something tonight, but at least true. I'm keeping him focused.
That is fair. Blood Moon, you are a wolf. With that,
crit.
A crit, a 24 crit.
Well, he doesn't have 11 points of damage, and he has to make another saving throw for DC 11 strength.
Wow.
All right, he has speed that time. I could get him twice. Barnaby,
poke him with the sharp end.
So Marcus, you hear this battle going on. Did you just want to try to escape your binds?
I feel your pain, Barnaby.
Oh, I don't know Marcus, what a DC is, but I mean...
Marcus, if you want to try and make a dexterity check or save, you can try to get free of your what's tying you up. Or he's not there. It's okay.
I'm just trying to figure out where I'm going to roll it from.
Yep.
Okay, I figured it out.
13, not quite enough. They got you tied up pretty good and gagged because, you know, you're a wizard. Ah, you guys are lucking out with this Noel Jailer. He rolls a 7 and just whiffs, he just swings wildly and hits right into the wall next to him as he is desperately trying to hit you. Alara, you are back up. 15 will miss. You could try to push him forward. That is an action that one of you could do to try to make some to get some separation. Just remind you, you could do a shove action as your attack. Bloodman, you're up.
I rolled anything higher than an 11. I don't think that would shove him anywhere.
No, does no. You have a 13 X at 11.
He has AC of 17, though.
So that misses.
That does miss. Barnaby? That will hit.
It's only a 15 because of his cover.
Oh, that's right. Thank you.
Good night, Isaac. Sorry, my 17 month is very excited to say goodnight to me.
Good night, Isaac. Well, you guys are lucky now because he rolls another 9 with a great axe. So you're back up, Alara, as you are still faced off with this this Noel Jailer. He's the biggest Noel that you guys have seen. He's certainly taken a lot of damage.
Okay, well, I'll try to push him through. See?
Yeah, well, it is a strength-to-strength check. So he makes the checks well and does not work, but it's worth a try. He is pretty strong. Bloodman?
23 hit?
Yeah, it does.
9 piercing.
Man, the
DC 11 strength save.
The wolf is doing a number here, isn't he?
Back tactics, really baby.
Bloodmoon, turn me into a wolf.
he stays on his feet. Hector, you want to try to rid it off your bonds again?
I will try. Fail.
Barnaby?
All right.
Yeah, pack tactics would have helped.
It would. Could I be a wolf too?
I'll try and push him out of the square so I can get behind a backstab.
Because that's what you do. Because you're a paladin after all. Oh, yeah, all right, 16 is a pretty good.
Same thing. But, yeah.
4. All Ooh. Right. Okay. So you shove him back and you.
And then I move.
Then you move in. So you have him in that kind of position there.
Let's see. I got to get behind him.
Okay. You can do that. He's going to whirl around and flash at you.
That'll hit.
Is that hit? All right.
Thank God you got the hit points.
13 points.
No, you didn't crit.
No. Oh, I'm sorry. Jeez, I don't know. Oh, just 4.
4 points.
4 points. That's pathetic.
Where was that when he swung at me?
I know, right? Alara, you're up. If you get in this square here, I'll give you advantage on it. That's fine. It's distracting enough.
Didn't need it.
Nope.
I know. And I maxed the damage. Look at that. 10.
Blood Moon, you're up.
I'm going to have to move through that square. So it's 10 feet of movement here.
Yeah, but that just halves your speed.
I can't see for some strange reason. Oh, because I'm the wolf form. And it doesn't have sight turned on.
Okay, my bad.
No, it's not you. It's ever since they changed the dynamic lighting on Roll 20.
I'll
read it to almost everything.
I'll update the token, so you're fine. Do you see now?
Yep.
Yep.
So, that's a miss.
It is. Hector, wriggle again. That gets you out of there. You managed to get your wrist free and in short order, you pull the gag off. And you can shout or do anything. You can't cast a spell yet, but you can, because that was an action to do all that. But as a pre-action, if you want to shout or say something, you can do that.
I will shout, "Who's there?"
You hear somebody shouting, "Who's there?"
We scream back, "You're doom!"
The holier than thou helpful paladin.
Hey, first three game sessions you yell at me for not killing evil. So I get a little bit more grumpy about it, then she gets mad at me for getting grumpy about it.
Hard to be your up.
Can't do anything right.
I'm a woman, what do you expect?
Paladin with a complex.
I believe a 13 will miss.
13 does miss. He hits you once. He's gonna stay on you. One on target. Wow, that's good.
Oh,
he
goes. Is lay on hands a bone reaction?
Can you lay a hand on yourself? And
I think
down?
We determined that crying was a free action, though. So.
He took 44 points of damage with that shot. Oh my god.
Oh Jesus.
Which is not the most he can do. He could do about, I think he could do around 30, almost 32 points on it. Well, no, I think it's, yeah.
Only like 3 points away from max.
Yeah. All right. Alara, you're up. After seeing Barnaby go down like a ton of bricks there.
Again.
That'll miss. Blood moon.
Okay, well, in for penny, in for pound. I see Barnaby go down. We'll move over the top of Barnaby to try to protect him. If I can do so. We're going to see.
Oh, there you go. Actually, you would have lost your pack tact. Well, it doesn't matter anyway.
No, she's still within 5 foot of him. It only requires one of the people to be within five feet.
You or the target? Oh, I guess it doesn't matter.
5 feet of the target. So.
Okay.
He takes 10 points of damage.
Well, that was just enough to do the job. And down he goes.
I am going to use my bonus action to release my shift.
All right, you resume human form.
Oh, and I'm going to medic him.
Okay. It'll be next turn. Yep. Hector, you are up.
I am ripping off my...
clothes. Come on, nude.
I am nude, yes.
They have over my eyes, I rip off.
Yep. Yeah, you are free of your bonds.
As is blood.
Yeah, see? You still have me blind.
What? No, it's just super dark in there. You're not blind. It's just super dark in there.
Am I in a box?
You are in a tiny little cell.
Actually, he doesn't know. It's that dark.
It is that dark. You feel around, and you are in a little 12 by 12 foot cell. You find the door. You feel around, and you feel damp, cold stone walls, and then right where you are right now, you feel the door more or less in front of you.
I kick at it and try to open it. Let me out.
Okay, make a strength check. Be a pretty good one. That's not good enough. An 8 will not kick down a lock.
We'll let you out after we stop our friend from dying. I don't know you.
He does have a key
that's
around
my
his
purse. I don't know you.
I don't know you. All right. The gnoll does have a key around his neck. A big old skeleton key on a piece of twine.
Is it made from an adventurer's skeleton?
Sinew.
If it looks evil, we'll have to destroy it.
Barnaby, make a death save, please.
I pass my first.
You make a death save. Hooray, Alara.
I'm going to let Blood Moon make the first medicine roll, because mine would be totally untrained, and I'd rather not hasten his demise.
There's no such thing as training.
Blood Moon?
Blood Moon does the typical rub dirt in it and try to stabilize him.
As Blood Moon makes the untrained medical check.
There you go. You are no longer dying, Barnaby. He rolls a 15. Well, you're not dying. I didn't say you're stable. You are no longer dying.
Yeah, that's what stable means.
As one of several definitions. All right, you turn away from Barnaby, Blood Moon. He appears to be no longer slipping away.
All right. I'm going to go look for where this noise is coming from.
From this door over here.
Can I see inside the doorway?
The door's shut, so you can't. It's a shut and locked door.
Ah.
Walk over to my throne torch, pick it up, relight it.
There's a backpack right here.
Ooh, we could rummage through it. Oh, wait, I'm down. Ah.
Grab the key from the downed jailer.
Sure.
Walk over to the door.
The key does fit.
I'm going to move back to Barnaby so nothing comes in behind us to hurt him.
Jiggle, jiggle. Open the door.
Open the door.
You see a decently long little corridor with cells. Obvious jail cells on each side. The noise is coming from the door closest to your right. Right here. You hear somebody inside banging at it and saying, "Let me out, let me out."
Hello?
Hello, let me out.
Who are you?
I am Hector.
Hector Ibarra? Ah, I have missed you. Where have you been?
Blood Moon, looks towards the corridor with, a very strange look on his face, because he's never heard that language be thrown out before.
I don't know where that came from, but that's okay. I'm willing to go with it.
Means nothing. Who are you, and what are you doing down here? Why should I let you out?
I'm just a traveler. I am an artisan. I was captured, and it's dark in here, and you're not a gnoll, so please let me out.
He doesn't sound like a gnoll.
Let him out.
Although it pains you greatly.
It does.
You open the door, and there's a somewhat disheveled-looking human in there. And I will let you describe him yourself, Hector.
Hector is...
He is, I'll let you know, he has very little on. I mean, he has just basic clothing. His wrists are raw. He's just down to his basic, tunic and trousers. And
yeah, like a traveling type clothes.
Well, they've stripped that off. You got your undergarments on, pretty much. You got practically nothing.
I got a nice six-pack, though.
Not like Blood Moon does. I mean, you guys got a contest on it, but Blood Moon is gonna. You guys could have set up.
Anyone else? Is there anyone else in here?
No, just me.
Are there skeletons? Any other bodies?
No, that was it.
I think I'm the only one captured. They were going to either eat me or sell me to some people.
Why? What are you worth?
Not much. I only have undergarments.
What are your skills in, artisan?
You see your backpack in the corner here.
My backpack over here. I'll go over to the backpack and I'll start showing them my alchemy kit. My alchemist supplies. I make elixirs and I brew.
You hear a bomb go. Brew.
Yeah, I know.
brew what?
Vom's not here.
Beer and stuff.
Vom, who's two levels forward, comes running in like Speedy Gonzales.
Let me be right back. My wife's yelling at me.
The dangers of D&D.
All right, I am going to see if I can't wake Barnaby up.
After a while, Barnaby comes to with one hit point.
I'm alive.
You don't look much better, Bloodman.
No, I am going to attend to my grievous wound, because it's just one, but it's really big.
He pierced you with that axe.
Not as much as the one that Barnaby got, but he had a bit more, he had more room to take that one.
Oof. Yeah, I'm just one scar. That was a meaty hit.
It was.
Who's that? You two punched up.
Says his name's Hector. I don't know what he does. He makes potions or brews or I don't know. Mixes stuff.
What's this do?
Blood Moon just looks over and goes, "I'm not babysitting the cub."
Don't look at me.
He wasn't looking at you when he said that. He said he was looking at the new guy. Barnaby is in serious, is in a serious way. We will need to find a safe place. We may have to come back to deal with the smith and the bird.
Well, the town's only like an hour and a half walk away.
We'll have to make a litter, and Vom and I will have to pull him.
Who? Me?
He can walk, but without taking time
till he
to
trips
rest.
On something and then is out cold for the next day.
As long as we don't cross a river, I'll be fine.
Devin, I'm going to search the knoll. Jailer.
Okay. You search the knoll, jailer. There is, within the room, either on the knoll or in his little nest over here, there are some things that look like they were probably taken from people that they had captured and either disposed of or ransomed. He himself has 11 gold pieces on him.
Okay.
There's a compass. There's a wooden holy symbol.
Of a wooden holy symbol?
Yes.
What god?
You would have to make a religion check. It's not one that you are. Okay.
Oh, I know it.
Yeah, you certainly do. It's it is Dwarfata.
Okay. That doesn't mean anything to me, but
it's the chief god of dwarves.
Ah.
There's a snapped longbow. Obviously, that's worthless. An empty scroll case. Just some junk.
I will actually put the compass with my mapping gear.
Okay. That could be handy, I'm sure.
Oh, hold on to the holy symbol. Obviously, it doesn't belong to the gnolls. Perhaps find who it did belong to.
And, I mean, he obviously had a great axe.
Yes, yeah, he very much had a great axe.
Which I don't know if Vom has any interest in because he's not here.
What is Vom using?
Axes. Hand axes, I think.
Let me look at Vom's character sheet.
He likes axes.
Currently has six. He has a great axe as well.
Okay.
That's his thing. They could have talked about axes and shared some drinks, but no. Instead, he was brutally murdered.
Hmm.
All right, back upstairs?
Yes.
All right.
Slowly.
Gather you guys up. Yes, slowly. Make sure he isn't tripping the stairs, because, well, you know how that could end up. Back to death saves again.
Me and Blood Moon hold each other up so we don't die.
That guy messed us up really bad.
Alara, quote-unquote, stands in the way, and everybody else goes down.
Oh. Hey, I do my part. I try.
I think that I think that that might be all of the goblins.
That was
except for the smith. Well, I mean, I think that might be everything that's here. We searched all the other locations.
I mean, there are doors you've not gone through, but... Yeah.
So...
Yeah, but behind those doors be treasure.
Maybe so.
We could go back to town using the road. Oh, I hate the road. And then come back. But I think, for the most part, our job here is done. Or we can retire to the woods and set up camp.
Well, the town's only an hour and a half away. Yeah.
All right.
We're not ready for that trap yet.
Everybody ready to go back to town?
I'm ready for a long rest.
That's, yeah.
Wherever we want to do that.
That's what Blood Moon is getting at. Do we want to take a long rest outside someplace? Do we want to go? Do we want to try to trek to town? Do we want to try to barricade here? Because we're well past being not in danger.
So Hector's a snake oil salesman?
That's the first thing that came to my mind, but well.
Snake oil salesman, traveling evangelist, who knows?
Well, do you guys want to look around this level to see what doors you've not gone through?
Just to be aware.
You would not, because you are not.
Hey, I have player agency. I can make my own decisions. I don't have to open the doors, but I can look and see what's left to see if it's worth coming back.
That's true.
Well, if you want to talk to the smith, we do have to come back. And I need to talk to the bird.
Well, let's make some decisions, guys. Hector looks fine. He's a pretty sturdy-looking guy.
Hector and Alara are in good enough shape.
Fair.
Did Hector put clothes back on, or is he blood mooning it?
He did, and I'm not sure. Did Blood Moon put clothes back on? That's more impressive.
Yes, Blood Moon got redressed while he was waiting for Barnaby to.
All right,
to
so that
heal.
Was not that was not your first impression that Hector got was Blood Moon in all of his glory.
No, I think it was actually. Alara got the key, unlocked the door. They came out.
And there was Blood Moon.
And then we waited a while for me to wake up. I think that's what Blood Moon.
In all of his glory. All right, guys, make some decisions. What do you want to do?
If you guys want to rest, I can look through other doors.
I would want to get Hector's input, but otherwise I would say go back to town, rest up, come back.
I mean, you can speak with animals, right, Bloodman? That's your goal?
Yes.
To do? All right.
Yeah, with the bird.
Okay.
I can do that on the way out. I should have relative safety without having to get too terribly close.
Do you need to see the beast in order to cast the spell?
Well, it's got to be within range to hear me.
Okay. If you could just post the spell so I can get a read on what you want.
Yeah.
Speech of the Woods. Oh, that's what you're doing.
Yeah. I need to see them to decipher their noises and motions, but I do, for all intents and purposes, it is speak with animals. What I was thinking is, I know that place is collapsed, but I'm sure there are spiders around. I could use my other wild shape to take the form of a small spider, climb up over, and converse.
Don't crows eat spiders?
Guys, make decisions.
All right.
My decision is to go wherever we want to make a long rest. If you want to talk to the raven on the way out, I'm all for that, as long as I'm not involved.
All right.
Unless I have to be. If combat starts, I have your back, buddy.
Let's do that, and we will come back and talk to the smith, because we also need to go to that oak tree that I need to garner the acorns from. So, we're going to head out.
All right. Everybody start walking. I'll walk Hector. He's looking around because he's never. He said, I haven't even seen this place. They brought me here blindfolded.
Sure they did.
I'm sure.
All your companions died except for you. I understand. Mm-hmm.
It was an eyes wide shut party he was going to.
Oh my god, what happened in this room?
I got shot, and I don't know anything else.
Please look at the room, the big dining room where the big battle happened.
Yeah, I remember opening a door.
Did you not survive that battle?
No, I got healed and we fought. But
okay.
I went down as soon as I opened the door.
He looks at the two crossbows. So the sound of the smith is obviously a little bit louder since you've come into the courtyard.
I mean, I'm interested in that guy, but I'm not ready to fight him.
All right.
Devin, is there an easier way to climb over here than there was on the other side? Like, climb up to see in? Is it more collapsed on the inside here where the bird's nest is?
Not particularly. It's just the shell of that tower. Of course, the sign's there, too.
Okay. And the door... I'm going to open the door slightly to see if there's anything behind it, like, or if it's just rubble. I think it's just rubble.
All right. You're going to open the door?
Slightly. Yep, to look inside.
Slightly. Okay. Are you trying to be sneaky as you do it?
You know what? I might as well. 16.
All right. You open the door a little bit. I'll move it like a little crack, like that.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I'll move to the side you're on.
Okay.
Go back to this. You open
it,
a slight crack. And good.
And I see the bird in there.
You see the bird in there. And I just want to see what its passive perception is. Okay. So it is not appear to have noticed you yet. You ease it open a slight crack, and it is brooding. It is like it's all kind of ruffled out, settled down in like a nest. It's not necessarily even facing your direction. It's just kind of in the space, all just kind of settled in.
All right, I'm going to use the best training I know to be calming when I'm speaking to the bird. So I don't know if you want to consider that animal handling or what do you want to consider that as, but...
It would be animal handling. You're trying to use persuasion or animal handling to try to be...
Calm it.
Calm to the bird. All right.
Yeah. So... 23.
All right. You make little cooing and clucking noises, I suppose. Whatever.
Do not be alarmed. I'm here to help you. I am a druid of the land. Are you all right? Things do not seem right.
You want to? You can see it there, right?
Yeah.
All right. The bird, its head snaps up, and its head swivels, and it faces you. And its eyes, in this sort of dark space, are glowing red.
Mm-hmm.
And it replies in something that is not bird language. It is...
Okay.
It is a language of blasphemy and vileness that you, I presume, do not understand.
I don't speak Abyssal or Infernal, if that's where it's going. I don't speak either of those.
I've got both of those.
So
are you lucky enough to roll both of those?
You don't have to roll those.
Yeah, you do.
No, you don't. You choose your language.
No, you get to pick them.
No, I rolled
you're not. Mine. You're not. What's your... You said you're staying somewhat of a distance away.
Wherever so I'm standing is where I'm standing. I mean, if it's bellowing, I'll hear it. But if it's, you know, conversation.
It is. But it is speaking kind of in a commanding tone at you.
I mean, I'm a good 100 feet away or something.
I don't think you're quite that, but yeah, you're a distance away.
Hey, wait for me. Real life stuff's over now. I get to come.
Yeah, you are. You're about a good 60, 70 feet away. So Blood Moon, it replies to you in a language that is blasphemous and vile and evil sounding. Not what one expects from a pleasant beast of the woods.
Right.
Go ahead and Barnaby, make a perception check and see if you can pick it up.
Okay.
All right. I mean, 20 is a good roll. Something about be gone or face my wrath and eternal damnation. Just usual kind of stuff.
What does it say, Barnaby?
It is, in fact, Abyssal that it is speaking.
I call out to Blood Moon. Do you understand the creature?
No.
It's speaking in a vile, evil tongue. I don't know that Alara could let it live.
I don't think Alara wants to tangle with this.
It is warning you to go away.
What has happened to you, Great Bird?
The bird doesn't really understand you. It is getting agitated.
Yeah, I'm gonna back off.
Do you shut the door or do you just back off?
Yeah, I'm gonna shut the door.
All right. You shut the door and you back off.
What are you guys doing here?
Talking Abyssal to a bird? You know, normal stuff?
Trying to figure out why there was a gigantic, evil, rack, demonic crow, whatever it is, you know, like you do.
Whatever has caused this.
Needs mean to you this region transaction, harm?
Or its transgression against nature. Did you wish to talk to the smith before we go?
Hector has not yet seen the bird or doesn't know anything about it, if you want to explain it to him.
Cub, do you know what a carriage is?
Like what people ride on?
Yes.
Yep.
Well, the bird is as big as the carriage, including the horses, before the wings. And it is apparently possessed of some evil power. Somebody has done this to this creature, and that person should have to pay.
Sounds like some kind of transmutation spell.
No, I think this thing is natural. Oh, are you talking about the smith?
You're talking about the bird.
He's talking about the bird.
The language it speaks is disturbing.
What is it?
Abyssal.
Demon language?
Not many things speak that language have good intentions.
I think it may be linked to the ogre in the woods. That's the only two and two I can put together with it. The fact that the dark, ominous, evil clouds were over the top of those woods. This is here after it was gone. And the ogre was the only thing we saw there.
But let's see what's the range of this thing.
I would not... I would not deny... Vom his hunt for the ogre.
I get about 30 feet closer to the bird, to the crow, and I use Divine Sense.
All right.
As an action, you can open my awareness. Until the end of my next turn, you know the location of any celestial fiend or undead within 60 feet of me.
Oh, yes. It is Do you have to see it? No, you just know it anyway.
You know the type of any being whose presence you sense, but not its identity. With the same radius, you also detect presence of any place or object that's been consecrated or desecrated with as with the hollow spell.
You're like right there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, move to the spot where you want to go.
As long as it's not behind total cover. So.
Oh, it is behind total. I mean, the door is shut, so it's behind total cover.
Yeah. And what's the point of this ability? in that case, I would be urged to try and get line of sight on it to determine if it is. So I would get closer.
To get line of sight. Don't want to do that. It's been agitated.
It is behind that door.
Can I peek through a crack in the door? I'll get close. If you need me to actually physically do it, I'll get close enough to look.
It's the door that has the sign on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But is it to where I can, like, is there a crack big enough I can look through a keyhole or something like that so I can just get eyes on the thing?
You know what? That'd be an investigation roll.
Okay.
16? Right. You can. There's a little knot in the boards that you can just barely see through. I'll give that to you.
Okay, then I would use the divine sense.
There is absolutely, positively a what is the list?
Celestial fiend or undead.
Fiend. It's definitely a fiend.
I walk back. Bravely yet quietly.
He slinks back to you guys.
Yeah. We are no shape to face this creature, but we cannot let it stay here. It is a fiend.
Agreed. But in our shape, we need rest.
Unless my god demands my soul today, as I look up to the sky.
Alara, you wish to talk to the smith before we go. We have not been fired on, so we should be in somewhat safety.
Hector, do you have any questions about what you're experiencing right now? You did not see any of this when you were brought in. You had a brief glimpse of a small castle or a large manor. As you're just beat up and hustled into this place and taken down some stairs and thrown into a cell.
Yeah, like, how did, like, who are each of you and why are you here?
Blood Moon looks over and says, "We were here to remove the goblin and gnoll threat. And obviously we were here to rescue you as a side piece."
I apologize. I was not awake when we freed, when I assume we freed you. My name is Barnaby. I am a man of honor and a defender of people.
My hand out to shake Barnaby's hand, and I tell him I am Hector the Artisan, maker of elixirs and ale.
I am Blood Moon. That's all he says.
Dried right in.
Alara seems to have moved her way over to the smith.
Yeah, there's a kind of a muscular looking goblin. He is busily just going to town, conducting blacksmithing work, hammering metal. He's working on an axe head right now. Goes, fires it up over here, bangs it over here, quenches it over here.
Does it appear to be the same type of axe the gnoll used?
No. It's more like a hand axe he's working on. Okay. You come walking in, Alara. He kind of looks up at you for a moment, gives you kind of like, tilts his head to the side slightly. Do you do anything?
I'm going to say that his services are no longer required for the group that was stationed here. And if he would like to continue his employ, I would suggest him seeking out a different location.
That sounds like a threat.
But I'm working on this right now. Why would you stop me? I've never had so much metal to work with. Look at this place. Just so much things I can rework and reforge. Pretty tough looking little guy.
We should go
is
to
this,
see.
Is this your place now? He looks up, sort of hopefully.
Is that all you want is to work?
He seems pretty happy.
Does it look like these go anywhere?
What's that?
Does the is there any doors or hallways inside this room?
No, just a little smithy built into the wall of this this keep. He looks up and says, "Gorbaz." He goes back to work. Then he looks back annoyed. I told you my name. What is your name?
Lara.
Ah. Alar. I'm Gorbaz.
Well met.
And he goes back to hammering.
Have your questions been answered?
Yeah. I don't have time to babysit.
He's doing
we should go.
Decent job at making...
I'd try to relocate him to the city, but if he's just going to stay here and pound on hot metal,
yes,
then,
because the people of the city have proven to be so open and armed that they would welcome a goblin smith.
Whatever. I'm not going to kill him for no reason.
Barnaby. What was in the lower area near the wall?
I could not see. There was no torchlight.
Were there doorways and things?
I may have gone in there and reported that there was nothing of note. But I could not see.
Where are you guys talking about?
Down here.
Let me zoom back.
Yeah, that would be the area that they originally fought the gnolls across
where
the courtyard.
Into there
next to
shot.
The next to the smith.
You saw Barnaby very dimly in the light, some bunk beds. Just some kind of rude and smelly bunk beds. It smelled like dogs.
Would you like to take a torch and go make sure that we are not leaving any enemies behind?
I'll go check. Do not require a torch. He's gonna sneak over there. Well, I mean, that's always the plan. Ah, okay. Impulse. Nemesis. Oh, everything looks pretty empty in here, Devin.
No, wait, did I? I may put the beds in the wrong layer. Hold on. Oh, okay, you can see the beds, right?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. For a second, I was afraid you couldn't. All right, yeah, you see some, it smells rather strongly of urine and dog.
Mm.
And you see some just rude beds. Some miscellaneous belongings here and there.
Okay. I'm going to head back out.
Were you going to give it more search than that, or just kind of just peek in, see what you saw, and then leave?
They just asked me to look to see if anything was still there before we left.
Okay.
So.
All right. You come back out.
There's nothing there. That's an easy place to block off if we wish to sleep here. Would save us from having to go all the way back to town and chance being attacked. Also, with the noise from the goblin smith, any noise we make would be covered.
Well, guys, what do you want to do?
Barnaby.
Well, again, I need a rest, but we need to do something about that fiend.
We're not going to do anything about it in this kind of condition. And I would rather make sure that the fiend is driven from the animal so that it may return to nature as it should.
As I said, a long rest is needed, if not two.
I believe there is a different source driving how that came to be with the crow.
You may have better knowledge than I on this topic.
But as it stands right now, we're all in very bad shape. If we need to rest, the room below us is defensible. It doesn't smell... Well, to you, it probably doesn't smell the best, but... I've been in worse tribal tents.
As I said earlier, wherever we wish to rest, I'm content. City, here, as long as we can recover and have a chance against that thing.
Alright, follow me then. Bloodmoon comes in here, grabs a couple of these broken pieces of wood, and heads in and builds a small fire in the back corner. Right here. That way, if something comes through the door, they're going to get lit up by the fire, and we'll have a better chance of seeing them. And then I'll move this bed to here, so it doesn't catch on fire.
All right.
Are you in agreement, Alara, that we need to destroy this creature?
Yes. I would like to know a little bit more from Blood Moon if it looks to be just a common raven, perhaps, that may be grossly enlarged and possessed, for lack of a better term, or maybe it is inherently an infernal being.
Nature roll, Blood Moon.
Okay. 15.
You're not sure what is a possessed creature. I mean, you can't.
I know
you
it's
can't,
not natural.
You can't rule out either possibility with a 15. So, you entertain the idea in your head that it could be a possessed creature, or its features did look a little weird. So, like, its head was especially kind of large and muscular seeming. Its beak proportionally larger and thicker than a raven of similar size. Very much a deadly weapon, more so than even one of those axes. You're not sure whether it's misshapen from a possession or that is itself. It is its natural form as a demon.
Because I do not think we have the resources to cast anything out. Therefore, I would say that death would be the only release to an infernal being from this party.
It's hard to tell whether or not this is a creature that is possessed by something, or whether it is natural. It is exhibiting behavior and features that don't necessarily look natural, but that could be a side effect from something being inside it. Even I was taken back when it spoke. The first time I encountered it, it didn't speak. It cawed back at me. So, the longer we've been in here, if it is possessed, the possession may be taking further hold. The other thing is, it looks like it's sitting on something. Whatever it's sitting on could be what's causing it to grow or gain further sentience. Either way, the beak is larger than the great axe that the gnolls carry, and probably quite a bit more deadly. I would not want to get hit by it. So taking it on head on could be calling out our weakness.
Are you guys having this discussion in this room over here?
Yes. Yeah, he's already made the little fire in there.
All right, well, everybody move to that
room. To make sure he doesn't kill everybody.
I will assume that during this time you guys are...
You know, long resting?
Are you long resting? That's fine.
Yeah, yeah.
If they're going to take a long rest, then I'm going to cast Mage Armor on myself. And then use... Well, I don't need to use Arcane Recovery. It'll be back after the... I'm just going to have it up.
Okay. Within this room, you find a loose stone. I figure you're here long enough to come across it. And beneath it, you find a small cache of items. Of most interest is a scroll tube that has a scroll within it, along with 56 gold pieces.
Any indication if it was the stash of the previous occupants or of the current gnolls and goblins?
It doesn't look too... it's not too filthy from time. It looks like it was sort of recently put in there.
Okay. It's probably payment for the gnolls' services from the goblins.
Yeah, so there's a scroll and a scroll tube or a scroll case and some cash, some gold.
Blood Moon will take a look at the scroll tube, open it up and see what's inside of it.
What are the rules on if it was a...
If it's a spell in my spell list, I should be able to read it. If not...
I guess there's no distinction between arcane spells and... It is a wizard spell. I'll just put it out there that way.
Alright, Blood Moon looks at it, puts it back inside the thing and tosses it down on the floor.
Okay. Did you say anything?
Yeah.
He threw a spell tube on the ground.
He just throws a spell tube on the ground and says, I can't read that.
I will mage hand it to my hand.
All right.
I will see what's it's about.
It is can you just read what it is? I believe you can, right? You don't have to cast read magic anymore in 5th edition. You can just kind of... it is, you can cast it from the scroll, but if you want to keep it, inscribe it, it is a scroll of the wizard spell hold person, 2nd level. If you want to take that down.
I got it on my notes, a scroll of hold person 2nd level. I will tell them that this is a scroll that will hold a person in place or a creature in place. Something I can cast and also something I can put in my spell book at a later time.
All right, so Blood Moon, I see you went to full hit points.
Yes.
How'd you accomplish that?
Long rest.
Long rest. So you spend a hit die to get during long rest. And probably a heal spell.
As soon as I get that long rest back, yes, you bet.
All right. Barnaby, you going to spend a hit die?
Yes.
All right.
Is our resident bard able to heal us a little?
Sure. She will get you healed up. So everybody go back to full health. Saris will assist you in getting your health back. After all, she is sort of here for those kinds of purposes. Until you leave this area, she'll go back to town. Alright, you are healed up and at full health and have your spells back and abilities. And nothing bothers you through the night. The goblin is practically non-fatigable. I mean, he is indefatigable.
I'm going to make sure that he gets any broken or crappy weapons from the armory and the other goblins and swap out what was in the armory at the other ones and just give him stuff to do. Keep him happy.
Yeah, you know what? He's very grateful for that.
Now, are the goblins' abs comparable to Blood Moon, plus minus?
No. No, they are not.
Hector's or the goblins?
The goblin.
Oh, well, Hector was also kind of bragging about some serious abs, too. Just,
well,
most of they could have seen it. I'd only had undergarments on until I found my backpack.
They all like to pretend they can be Blood Moon.
I mean, Blood Moon has a 10-pack.
He just keeps getting bigger. Soon it'll be a 12-pack. Like, there's abs. The abs have abs. That's how many abs there are. It's abception.
All right, you are rested. It is the next day. Where do you wish to go?
Blood Moon looks over at Hector and says, if you're going back to town, we won't be going there straight away.
What do you guys... What is your plan?
We are going to the woods nearby. There is something I require.
And you do believe that the link between the woods, there is a link between the woods and this fiend?
No, that's the woods to the south. Okay. I'm looking for the great oak to the west.
Okay, so you need something to fight the fiend.
Yes.
Very good.
Where the bear prints were. The great spirit bear. Although it'll look pretty physical to most of you.
It was a big bear print. Alright. Do you guys leave? Or
yes,
do you want to search for any other rooms that you've not gotten into here first?
I think we've done enough here.
No, we'll be back.
Yeah, are you sure? You were really interested in finishing out the search of the rooms.
We can always come back.
We are coming back.
Not to mention the fact that you're interested in the money that was offered in town.
I'm not interested in any money.
All right. You guys are right there. The great oak was located right in that bit of woods right here.
Right here. Yep.
Yep.
So Blood Moon will take the lead and start heading that direction.
It's only about a mile, half mile away to the edge of the woods.
So Hector, your caravan was jumped by these gnolls?
Yes, they were.
Where were you heading to or from?
I was just traveling from town to town. I'd like to learn different way of brewing and different
So you were alone, not with the caravan?
Yeah, I wasn't. I was just traveling with it. I'm just what they call
a fool traveling alone in these lands.
a snake salesman, I guess, is like the layman's term. A snake oil salesman is kind of, but you know, my... And it's not like that. I don't pretend that my stuff heals people. I'm just learning to be a better alchemist.
Yeah, go ahead.
And I'm just looking to find some new things to make. There's always different ways to brew and always different ways to make things.
You
learned man with an open mind and heart to learn all that is out there to learn. We respect one such as you upon our journey. Come forth and join us in our quest.
All right, you arrive at this woodland that is along the north. The woods kind of just arcs, continues on from the north bank of this river onto the south bank. And even as you come to this bit of woodland, you see in the center one particular oak tree that towers a great deal above the rest of them.
Blood Moon stops and he points and he says, "That is the destination. Do you wish to stay here or do you wish to accompany me?"
I'm not going to stay here by myself, so I will accompany you.
I'll be just ahead of you. Blood Moon starts to head through the forest, letting them keep him in sight. Yes. So they know where to go. He's an attempt to go quietly.
Do you have survival tracking?
Yes. Yep. And I am proficient in it.
Okay. I'm gonna make a GM roll. Hold on.
Just try not to step on a twig.
Hey, at least there's not a big tree going across the water to try to fall off of.
That's probably very bad for you.
What is your, All right.
Are we in, like, DC universe?
Are you what?
Yes. The Batcave.
Batcave?
Oh, the crevice above the crevice above the castle I have marked as the Batcave, because you'd said it looked like a slit where bats could come in and out.
You are working your way through the forest, and this bear, which you've seen the tracks of it, it is a great huge bear. I rolled for its stealth, and it was really very, very high. So you did
not. Yes, it was incredibly high.
You didn't. Could you see that roll?
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought I had. I thought it was a GM roll that you couldn't see.
Nope.
Yeah.
Maybe you. All right. It wrong. That's why I said it's very bad for us.
It is. So you did not hear it at all. Like, you've seen The Revenant, right?
Right.
No.
No, that was a Caprio film.
A what?
A DiCaprio film.
No, yeah. I did not see it because of him. I just hadn't seen it.
There is a particular scene. There's a particular scene in The Revenant, which is... Where are you in relation to everybody else, Blood Moon?
I would have been about 40 feet ahead of them. So okay. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40. So I'd have been right up about here.
All right.
Because I never want them to be right on top of me.
All right. So... you may not be a Leonardo DiCaprio fan. However, the scene when he is attacked by the bear is utterly terrifying. It's worth watching the 2 minutes of seeing that happen. And so it is somewhat reminiscent of that, as a gigantic bear comes charging through the woods at you. You had no idea it was coming in your direction. I will give you the benefit of because I'm a kind person. I know you guys say otherwise, but
all right, sure.
I'll give you an initiative roll against it. Otherwise, it would be like surprise round stuff. But I'm not gonna do that to you.
Well, we all assume this is part of his plan.
I pull out my cell phone to film this, Molly.
So there's a story behind that. So Ted and I were in Yellowstone, and somebody had a dog, and there's a bear, and it was me. It wasn't Ted. It was me.
Like, you told us the story.
Get your camera. There's gonna be a mauling.
No, I was doing the whole making noise thing, but after the bear almost jumped over me, I started making more noise.
All right. Fortunately for you, the bear did roll a 3. Coming out of the brush is... The bear has auburned red fur. It is unusually colored. It is the size of a polar bear or a cave bear, but it is not quite brightly red colored, but it is definitely red. And it is coming out of the trees at the first person in front, which is Blood Moon.
At this point, I am assuming this is part of his plan.
Alara, are you going to assume this is part of his plan?
I'm going to make lots of noise and bang my shield and try to get it to not attack Blood Moon.
Good idea. What skill would you associate with that particular thing?
Assist or help.
Or persuade or intimidate or...
Animal handling.
Animal handling. I will let you make. I'll let you roll intimidate, which I know you're not trying to scare it away, but you're trying to get its attention. Make me a charisma based roll. Wow.
Look at that.
All right. It is. It has turned and redirected towards you, Alara. Hector.
I look over at her, like she is crazy. And I, like, fumble back away from her in fear of this huge bear. And without realizing what's going on, a rock next to her shoots straight towards the bear.
Okay. That is your catapult spell.
Yeah. It's a good spell.
Okay. And it's a DC 13 dex save. Gotcha. That is a fail. So 10 points and El Barrow.
I'm going to make a dex save of 12. And he trips over like a branch or something. And he's on his butt.
Wait, what?
He's not used to combat. He's...
Blood Moon, you are up.
Blood Moon turns towards it, reaches into his pouch, and holds something in his hand, the bear, and casts Animal Friendship.
Animal Friendship. Alright. Let me see what his intelligence is. Intelligence is 2. So, succeed a wisdom save.
Yeah.
Animals are surprisingly wise.
Yeah, they are. And my spell save DC is incredibly...
The bear is taken in by your charming presence. Are you going to warn the others that you've done this?
Yeah, I'm going to put my hands to the side and I'm going to say, don't hurt it. Don't hurt it. And you see me approaching it and I have something in my hand. It's actually a small bit of honey. But I'm approaching it with it. We mean you no harm. We won't be here very long. We just need something from the Great Oak.
Right. You do notice as you are closing in on this bear that there is a considerable amount of...
Bodies?
Human remains.
Now that's their fault.
I was waiting to see. I knew you were going to say that.
That's exactly how he would look at it. That's their fault.
That's nature.
Yep.
All right. The bear nuzzles your hand and licks the honey from it.
All right.
Hector will stand up slowly and pretend that him tripping over that tree branch didn't happen. And
like a cat.
Barnaby fought his instincts to backstab Hector as he was prone.
Struggle is real, my friend.
I'll scratch the bear behind its ears, and since I have speak with animals, I'll say, do you know what the black cloud has been that's been flying over the forests? Which you guys actually can hear what I say normally.
Bring up the ability. I just want to see what an animal can relate to you.
I'm having to figure out body language, so it won't be... I'm bringing it up for you now.
Yes.
Just a quick question. On the back of the character sheet, if I hit spell points on, will that minus my spells as I cast them?
I don't think it does it automatically. I think you have to just click off. I don't know the answer to that.
Spell points might be the optional rule.
Yeah, I think that's the optional rule for spell points. I think Dave's
I'm right. Not sure, but that'd be my guess.
Yeah, just tick them off as you cast them per level. And just reset them after a rest. Let me read this real quick. The bear is not really sure what you are referring to. The bear expresses confusion.
Storms overhead. Have you seen a bird, a large bird in the storms that have been over the woods nearby recently?
Well, I just want to make sure you are not... didn't misinterpret some of the stuff that I told you. The ogre hut is in the adjacent forest to you guys, and that area has kind of like a darkness spell over it. Not like a full darkness, but like a gloom about
it. Okay, then I misconstrued that. I didn't realize that. I thought that it had left that area when the sun came up. That's where I thought it went with the bird. So
okay. So no, to be clear, I brought you back to that map. The ogre hut is here.
Right.
And when you were looking at it from the hillside up here, this forest has a gloom upon it that seems to be centered upon the ogre's hut.
Okay. So it's two separate things.
And that is still present, that gloom. Okay.
All right. Okay. I am going to I'll give another morsel of food to the bear, and my friends will not hurt you. You can go back to your home, and I will ask what to call it.
The bear has this oak tree in the center has, so the trunk of it is like 20 feet around, and it has a natural kind of small cave or gap leading into the interior of it, and that is where it has made its lair.
All right. Looking up or looking down on the ground, do I see some of the acorn I'm looking for should be rather large?
This tree is producing magnificently large acorns. They're about the size of like a hen's egg.
Okay. I'm going to tell the bear, I just wish to retrieve one of the acorns. I don't want to go into your lair or anywhere near it. Just, I want to retrieve one of those.
Bear says the acorns are very tasty.
Ooh. And I will walk over and I will look for which one I can find that is.
The bear says, how do you think I got this large?
I look at the human bodies around there and go, healthy eating.
But so yeah, you find an exceptionally good specimen of acorn.
Okay.
It's got the little cap on it, and it was green. It's beginning to slightly turn that golden color along the bottom of it. It's just this magnificent acorn.
Okay.
Slightly larger, slightly smaller than a goose egg.
Perfect. Okay. Does it have a name?
It gives you a name, but it knows its color, so it is the Red Bear.
The Red Bear. I wish it well, give it another morsel, scratch it behind the ear, and walk back to the party.
You head back.
Blood Moon comes back with this beautiful acorn that's huge.
The bear just kind of shuffles into its little den and disappears.
It fit in its little den.
The trunk is 20 feet across, so its den is not that little, but it squeezes in there and settles down. You hear it kind of go...
Blood Moon does something slightly uncharacteristic. As he walks over, he stops, and for a moment he looks over to Alara and says, "Thank you for attempting to draw the bear's ire away from me." And then he turns and he continues walking past Barnaby. "Where should we go now?"
"I thought you needed to come get something to fight the fiend."
"I have it."
"Do you think we can face it now?"
"I do not think the time is yet right."
"What else do we need?"
"This is what I need. However, I do not think the time to face the fiend is now."
"We should go back to town and let them know that the gnolls and goblins have been taken care of, so people can resume along the trade route as long as they are careful of the forest."
"Very well."
"And the keep."
"I shall take the lead." And Blood Moon stops and says, "Do you wish to take the road for time?"
"Sure. We should regroup with Faum and Siri to face that fiend."
He kind of looks, he shrugs and he kind of looks disinterested at the idea of taking the road, but he moves forward to do so.
All right. You express your distaste of taking the road, but do it
reluctantly. We know, but we need to relay the road's conditions to the townspeople.
All right, you don't encounter anything on your way back. And after walking for an hour and change or so, it's not that far. You work your way along the river, across the two fords. That's probably I take that back. It's probably a good 2 hours to get to the town. And you arrive once again at, I gotta make sure, I don't think, all right, there we go. You arrive again at the place that you're trying to get to, Hector, before you got attacked. You arrive at Zelkor's Ferry. And for your benefit, Zelkor's Ferry is a small, muddy settlement. A very rudimentary, rude place on a little peninsula along the edge of the river. There is a little wall that is protecting its western flank. The rest of it is more or less protected by the river. And there is a cluster of buildings, barracks, there's a smithy, there's an inn, a pretty decent-sized inn, the stables, some other smaller outbuildings. And that's all there is here. There's some group of people moving around. There's often a keelboat here unloading a cargo. And that's all there is to this place. There's not much to it. It is named for the archwizard Zelkor that fought in the battle against the forces of darkness.
Looks like there's a witch over here that needs to be judged.
There's a fellow outside there. He's kind of lounging up against his structure. It's a big A-frame building, decked out with... Well, you'd kind of recognize this stuff. There's some herbs There are a number of bones and skeletons and skulls hanging from pieces of twine.
Oh, my guy. Oh, my perfect, like a buddy. Hey, friend.
I mean, you might have some interest in common.
How are you doing today?
Do you go over there?
Yep.
All right. He kind of gives you a little sniff and greets you.
I'll ask him if he's, I'll show him my guild badge as a, my papers as a guildsman and an alchemist, and ask him if he does, you know, that kind of stuff too, and if he'd like to talk shop for a little while.
He says, well, the name is Ullman Dark. I, came about my skills in slightly less traditional fashion, shall we say.
So his name was Dark Ullman?
Ullman Dark. One thing you see there that is kind of note, looking at his shop, is that tacked to the door is a piece of paper, vellum paper, with a fairly in a fairly strong written hand. There is a list of things, and I'll show it to you. He sees you reading that over his shoulder. Yes. The hand of Hecate brought that by, as she often does, and posted it. She had heard that there were adventurers about, and decided to leave that in case somebody wished to take her up on it.
I'm going to look at his shop. And I'm going to make an Arcana check if I can get kind of a flavor of what this guy is.
Okay, I'll let you do that.
A pretty mediocre roll, so... Oh, he dabbles in everything.
He does. Probably a little bit on the dark side. Looking at some of the symbols and things, he dabbles in all sorts of things, but probably there's a reason why he doesn't have standard guild credentials. Looking at what his methods are, they're slightly unconventional.
You're supposed to keep those frogs alive. You're not supposed to grind them up. But it does the same thing.
Really, it's you don't need to feed them this way. It's far less work.
Yeah, we just missed that living priestess of Orcus.
Oh, do you say that? I'm smart if you say it out loud. That's all.
No, I wasn't reading. Whatever it is, that was.
Okay.
Now we gotta resurrect it for the bounty.
I'm gonna say good day to him and go back to the group, and I'll tell him there's some bounties listed over in that guy's thing. I don't know if you guys have done any of it, but. There is a bounty over there for some things.
Well, we should probably check in with the innkeeper first.
Okay.
Odo and Squarma.
All right, you go in there. We'll move you to the inn. My in map. I made an in map. I know I did. Sorry, give me 1 second, excuse me. There it is. Sorry. All right.
I'll be right back.
All right, you guys make your way into the inn.
Ben?
What do you guys wish to do in here?
Drink!
Drink! Go to behind the bar. There's Skorma, the captain of the guard. He's present. Yes. You're going to say Hector?
I want to see how he's got his setup here, how he does his ale. Is it all done here, or does it look like there's another place that he does all the fermenting?
Do you wish to ask him, or do you want to figure out just by taste?
I'm just perusing, and I will do it by taste also. Although, was there gold left in my backpack?
Yes, they're not taking the gold out of the backpack.
All right, so I'll have some. I will buy everyone a drink that has saved my life from those dirty gnolls.
That is uncommonly kind of you. All right, you set up to the bar, and the barkeep is a kind of a irritable looking fellow. He looks a little bit like Wolverine. He's got big sideburns. His hair is kind of bristly. He's like, you're different. There's two missing, and you've brought another one. Who is this man? I promised rooms for you doing the task, but I don't think he was included in the price.
I am going to. Blood Moon's going to come sit on this table over here and play his pan pipes. Okay. Like he normally
task
does.
Accomplished.
The captain, Skorma. Says, has it? Took you long enough. You're out for several days. Really, we thought you weren't going to come back. So what was in that place?
Larger issues. Got a company of goblins and gnolls led by a priestess of Orcus.
So a human priestess? That'd be very alarming.
No. It was a goblin priestess.
He kind of snickers. A goblin priestess? I didn't think they were capable of such a thing.
Well, they're...
Was she powerful? Was she...
She's dead.
Well, I guess she wasn't that powerful then.
Benny goes back to playing his panpipes.
Hector, the ale is aged and slightly soured. You do not believe it is... brewed here. It is probably brewed someplace else and then shipped here. Looking at this town, there's not much means. There's some outlying farms here and there, so the means to produce for brewing seems to be somewhat limited.
But they've been capturing the travelers and feasting on their corpses.
Well, that is alarming.
Our friend here that arrived with us had been next on the menu.
What was this priestess doing? Are you sure it was Orcus?
Yes.
What powers did she manifest? What were her abilities? He's very concerned and wants to know more about this.
She raised the dead to fight for her.
As in, like, zombies and skeletons, that kind of thing?
Yes. There was a great shrine to Orcus that no longer exists. And a great, powerful spell book that we had thus destroyed.
That is disturbing. This would seem to suggest, although I do not know, I've never heard of a goblin following that dark path. But as you know, the Dungeon of Graves, or maybe you don't know, is said to be still the home of several shrines to Orcus. And we have become concerned that they are beginning to flex their muscles and spread out from their dark place into the surrounding lands. It is fortunate that adventurers such as you have shown up that can perhaps drive them back. Or eliminate them, if one dared to go that deep.
I take out what the... Oh, God.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, if he's still talking, let him finish.
No, he was going to say, what else did you find?
I take out the holy symbol of the dwarven god and ask if anybody had come through, a worshiper, perhaps likely a dwarf, with this emblem.
Well, the gem cutter is a dwarf. But I fear that perhaps dwarves were on the way here and did not make it if that symbol was found within that keep.
It was. It was amongst a lot of broken and battered goods.
Dwarves do not fall easily, so... Were they... Anything else of note? Goblins are not known to be terribly powerful. That's why they take gnolls in their employ.
There were gnolls, goblins, and there appears to be a fiend taking housing there.
A fiend?
A fiend. It is in the shape of a very large avian creature.
It's a crow.
So these are fancy words. A crow. A large crow?
Yes. Think the size of a house.
Blood Moon stops playing his panpipes, looks over and says, have you seen a carriage before?
Of course.
It's as large as the carriage, along with the horses before the wingspan.
Do you think it is a danger to travelers as well?
Yes, it is a fiend.
Well, it's not there to hug them and send them on its way.
It will
need to be dealt with. The crime against nature alone has to be dealt with.
Well, you've dealt with the gnolls and the goblins, though. That was the task that I set you upon.
Yes.
All right.
Thaum has an entire necklace full of their ears.
So you know what I. Proof. I like that. That is a good technique. I tell you what, my friends. He steps forward. If you can claim more goblins or gnolls, and bring me their left ear, or which one was Vaughn taking? I think he said the right ear.
Right ear.
Right ear. Bring me the right ear. I will pay you. Starting now. Not for the ones that you've already slain. I'm paying you for those. 10 gold for every goblin and 25 for every gnoll. Hopefully by that, I'll make that known far and wide. We can start to cull this infestation of these horrible creatures. Was there anything notable? Well, we had a goblin priestess or priest. Anything else that I should know about them?
One of the goblins, the... head boss goblin said he was from a larger city or town or area, and he was a mere harbinger of a greater force. What might he have been referring to? He had quite the knowledge of poisons.
Did he? It is said. There have been many adventurers who've gone into the Dungeon of Graves, that there is a large goblin city that is deep in the bowels of the place, and that they have some sort of entrance and exit that they use that is secret. This goblin city can be found by venturing down through the depths of the dungeon, but the goblins have their own secret way to get in and out without having to go through all those levels. That is what I've been told by other adventurers such as yourselves who have braved those depths. And these goblins are not to be trifled with, more powerful and stronger than little goblins that we see on the surface.
Yes, we saw that.
That would seem to agree with what we saw.
All right, well, he counts out the coins. What was it, 250, I think?
I don't know. Barnaby wasn't taking of it, though.
Sounds... Yes, it was 250.
All right, he counts out 250 coins. Puts them on, turns around, and puts them on the table that Blood Moon is sitting upon.
I offer back my share to go toward any families that may have been impacted by them, by the gnolls and goblins from this
Blood
town.
Moon gives 50 gold pieces out to each person.
All right. You are very generous, Bartleby.
Except for this one gold piece. This one gold piece shall be for my drink.
Have you anything else? Any other intelligence that you can tell me?
Cottage.
Do you know of the wood where there is a darkness above the land?
Well, of course. It's obvious from here. There is an ogress that resides within. She is very powerful. She tends to stay to the woods, but sometimes teams up with bandits. That is something that you should be concerned about, is the banditry in the area. Some of the bandits have gotten very clever.
I've heard some of them act as snake oil salesmen.
I will not interrupt. I will not interrupt, but I will whisper that there's a reward for live bandits.
You whisper that to Barnaby or to Laura?
Yeah, and both of them.
Okay. Some of the bandits have decided that rather than risking their own lives going into these dungeons and places, that they've decided to, and this is rather clever when you think about it, they have set themselves up so that they can waylay the adventurers as they emerge from it, fat with loot and weakened by their endeavors. So if you go to these places, you should take caution on the way out. It's not safe until you reach town. Have you heard of or found your way to, is sometimes called the Mouth of Doom?
Are you referring to the Batcave?
I'm not familiar with the Batcave.
He stops playing his pinpipes. The crevice on the mountainside above the castle. The manor.
I am not familiar with it.
It's where you sent us.
There's an overlook
that has a cave or a crevice that goes down to where there are bats.
I am not familiar with... I'm familiar with the keep that you speak of. I do not know every little cave and nook and cranny that's upon that hill.
Must not be the Mouth of Doom.
The Mouth of Doom, you would know if you saw it. The Mouth of Doom is south of here. It's in the Great Wood to the south, but there's a large hill. It is said that the Mouth of Doom, if one was to follow all the tunnels and go deep enough into it, will take you all the way to the Dungeon of Graves. It is, which, as the crow flies, is quite some distance from here. Several score miles, I believe. Whether that is safer than venturing in from the mausoleum at the Dungeon of Graves or not, I'm not going to be a judge of that. From here to the Dungeon of Graves is... It's 60 miles as the crow flies.
I don't know. We've seen that crow, man. She's terrifying.
Poor choice of words on my part.
Does the name Maybeth Kalilin mean anything to you? Kalilin?
Kalelins. They were the previous owners of the keep, or the manor.
Ah. We found a journal of Maybeth's while we were there. Also a locket.
They disappeared, or she was an adventurer before my time here. And they all disappeared exploring these places. As far as I know, there's not yet any claimant to that castle. I imagine in time this pass to the duchy is cheated, as the term goes. That has not happened yet. Go to the. It'll be, if there's no heir to take it over, then it will go to whoever granted the land centuries ago. However, no one has taken much notice of anything around here, so I suppose that hasn't happened yet.
Do you know of the woods to the south of the keep?
I know that it is dangerous. I know that there's a large bear there that has occasionally taken a traveler or two.
I would suggest your people avoid it. The great red bear just desires to be left alone. Unless you want more people to be culled, I would dissuade them from going there.
I will certainly take your advice, my friend. I have heard of the Great Red Bear. It is a known danger.
It's simply a warning.
And there's the bear. Of course, there's the ogress.
We have seen her.
That is, and the gnolls in the hill, I believe you took care of.
Yes.
That's most of the things around here that I'm aware of. Of course, there's also the Mouth of Doom, which you probably cannot tame, but it is near at hand.
What is the myth about the ogress? What do you know about her?
What the main thing that is of concern is she has the ability to render people asleep. She can force them to sleep. And when she does, she ransoms many of them back to here to Zelkor's Ferry, but usually claims one for her cooking pot. She's no ordinary ogress. She has a name. Whether it's her real name or not, I don't know. But her name is Yorgala. She occasionally preys on people taking the trail, but otherwise tends to keep to herself. Like the bear, most people are relatively out of danger if they don't go poking around too much in their places. But Yorgala occasionally will team up with some gnolls and cause some trouble.
I think perhaps Mom wanted to mate with her.
I would not advise that.
I would not advise that.
He just wants to tame the beast.
Feed the tiger.
Once you go ogress, you
can't get the smell off.
Right, that's
in his right. Culture, domesticating a woman is, you know, such a thing.
Right.
Hector, you were talking about the bounty. You're not necessarily discussing it with this guy, but did you?
No, I was just telling everyone that there's a bounty on bandits. You bring them back alive.
Okay. You're not really sure about the details of that, so you might want to.
Barnaby. I wonder. The goblins. The city supposedly is hidden away somewhere underground, from what he has said. The crevice above the castle. You think that was big enough to make an easy travel for goblins?
It would have been precarious for us, but for especially the stronger goblins, it should prove easy.
Are you saying that close to the captain?
Yes. He's speaking normally.
Okay. I hear your theory on that. I believe that... So he's going to lay out a map. Sort of a map of the area.
I have this in my back pocket. Come, let's strategize.
He does.
Just so you know, I'm hearing the winds through my headset start to whip up, so if I disappear, you'll know why.
True.
Nature is calling the Blood Moon.
Yeah, it looks like there's a little band about to hit your area, Tony.
Okay, can you guys see that map?
I see black. Let me pull out a little bit. Yeah, it's all black for me.
I don't have... Oh, turn Diana Clayton off. There we go.
Ah.
There we go. All right. He pulls this map out. And explains. So, I'll use this to kind of do distances.
I ask him why his map has a fiendish skull upon it to frighten us all.
That's how they made it.
Why the eyes glowing? What type of map is this?
Why the Mace of Orcus is there?
Why not? So he points and says, all right, we are here. That Zelkor's ferry right there. Here. To here. Is where the Dungeon of Graves is. I don't believe that the goblins are utilizing any kind of an exit from here to get in and out of their city. I'm pretty sure that any way in and out is in these foothills, these coastal hills, which are near to where the Dungeon of Graves is.
So you believe they're traversing above ground to get here?
Well, I imagine some of the more advanced goblins that you're seeing are either going through the Mouth of Doom to get here, or they are going across country. I believe that the goblins that are of smaller stature that you have defeated and dealt with, more surface goblins, the smaller weakling goblins, they are probably not coming from that great city. There seems to be a division between goblins. There's the ones of the deep earth, and then there's the ones at the surface. Mm-hmm. The deep goblins seem to hold the surface goblins in little regard, although they do lord over them when they can. Perhaps you've seen something like that.
Yes.
And up here, of course, the troll fens. In the midst of that is the Bone Hills. Well, it's a great and wild land full of many hazards. We are just a small corner of it here at Zelkor's Ferry.
Well,
he's going to be pausing. If you have any, if you have any questions, otherwise he starts to roll up the map.
No questions as to the map.
All right. There's this area. He points the area of the Dungeon of Graves. There's many, many caves and nooks and crannies that perhaps lead into the greater depths of the place. The main entrance to the Dungeon of Graves is a great mausoleum that's in the midst of a vast graveyard and a hollow of earth there. Listen, there's no hiding the Dungeon of Graves. The path to it is well trod. There's no mystery as to where it is. The main danger is not in finding it. The main danger is coming out of it. So, He rolls the map up and puts it away. And I suppose it's at 10 o'clock here on the East Coast, so I will say that is enough for this evening.
Well, thank you, guys.
Everybody, including Marcus, gets 200 experience.